am the director of One Flushing, and I wanted to first say good afternoon. How's everyone doing today?
Good
afternoon. Great. I'm going to start with a slogan and end with a slogan. Many people say that we should think globally and act locally, and I think that's how I've been living my life and how my career has developed over the past 20 years. As the director of One Flushing, we bring many different groups together in Flushing, whether you're African American, Latino, Asian American, or non-Asian. We work in conjunction with many of the small businesses and residents who have made Flushing the great town that it has, that it is now and has always been. And I wanted to maybe go back a little bit historically. Seth mentioned that Flushing was founded by the Dutch, but it was not the Dutch government. It was a Dutch corporation, the Dutch East India Company. And as many of you know, the Europeans were trying to get to India, and they accidentally found America. And you know, if you look at the great game that the professors here mentioned, the prize has always been India. The Indian labor, Indian resources, Indian religious and intellectual power. India has always been a powerhouse, and I think the South Asian community here in New York has proven how potentially powerful you are as a community. You have some of the highest rates of education and career advancement in this country. As a community, you have some of the highest incomes and advancements in social and economic fields. So you have much to be proud of as a community, but we can do much more. And I'm going to talk a little bit about that. But you know, going back to India briefly, you know, ever since Alexander the Great tried to conquer, you know, the Middle East and Afghanistan, you know, Europeans and people from Europe have always been trying to take control of the Indian subcontinent. And if you look at the current invasion, the U.S. invasion of Afghanistan, you can see that that is still part of the great game situation that's going on. You can go back previously to the Soviet Union, and even before that, 1830s, to the British invasion of Afghanistan. These were all centered around possession and domination of the Indian subcontinent. And so I think it's still, unfortunately, a sad indictment that while we would like commercial development to predominate, much of our economic policies are enforced by military power. And that's still a reality that we have to face today. And it's a reality that we suffer from. As Seth mentioned, you know, our economic system here is very much, you know, geared towards the military. We spend trillions of dollars fighting two wars. Much of that money could be used to help build the infrastructure in this country, the educational infrastructure in this country. The small business community needs a lot of help. And I'm going to talk a little bit about, you know, Flushing even more. Flushing started out, as Seth mentioned, as a Dutch colony. And it became well known as a center of religious tolerance, but also early on as a center of education and learning, and also as a center of commerce. Education came from the Quakers. The Quakers, who were persecuted by Stuyvesant, actually ended up starting some of the first free schools in New York. Flushing High School, and I'll talk about Flushing High School a little bit more, was the first public school in New York. And it was the first racially integrated public school in New York. Many of you don't realize that Jim Crow was not just in the South. We had segregation in the North as well. We had slavery in New York City. In fact, the financial center of slavery was Wall Street. Commerce. Flushing is very well known for its early tree nurseries. If you look at many of the great trees in national parks or even Central Park, they come as direct descendants of the trees that were taken from Flushing. They're grown and nursed and sold in Flushing. There were stories about how George Washington and the Founding Fathers came to Flushing to purchase streets here. So we have an amazing history here, a very rich history. It's not a coincidence that we have over 130 languages spoken in Flushing. We have one of the highest concentrations of religious institutions and houses of worship. You have Sikh gurdwaras next to Jewish temples, synagogues, next to Christian and Catholic churches, next to Quaker meeting houses. All sorts of religious institutions sit side by side in Flushing. In fact, I'm always impressed when I come to the Hindu temple how much you change every time I come here. It seems like you're growing every year, physically as well. And I think, you know, we have to look at Flushing in the context of this history, this rich, very rich history. It's not a coincidence that we live in one of the most diverse towns in New York and even the world. But we do have some issues in Flushing. Flushing, even though it has prospered greatly, as Seth mentioned, we have a large foreign population. So, you know, when I talk about these issues, you can see it from a very positive aspect or a very negative aspect. So half our population is foreign-born. To me, that's an amazing resource, but some people in the community feel that's actually a limitation and a weakness in Flushing. We have over 6,000 businesses. 90% of those businesses are small businesses. They employ less than 10 people in Flushing. Flushing has also phenomenal job growth, 3.1% job growth over the past years. During a recession, when even Queens and the rest of the country was stagnating economically, we have $1.7 billion in wages that are generated in Flushing. That's a 17% increase over the past couple of years. We're also an intense transportation hub, the terminus of the 7 train, the LIR station here.